Hi, we're Colts, and you're watching us on the interface on spinner.com.
Please identify to think about rescue because they were calling psychics to find you, and that's a kind of thing that I do.
And you're a thing that I've been adopted. I knew a thing that you would be taking my heart. I knew a thing no one was above him. I knew a thing that he would be breaking my heart.
My brother's show in San Diego, and he was tour managing, which means he like sort of hopped on for a free ride. Yeah, he hopped on for a free ride out to California, and I was in San Diego visiting my dad, and we met at the show, and he snuck me in because I wasn't 21 yet. He wasn't 21 yet either, but somehow he worked some kind of magic.
Yeah, but she was moving to New York, and then she ended up coming to the rest of the tour, and we went to like Las Vegas and San Francisco and all these cool cities, and ended up moving in together when we came back.
Who's curious me? I never wanna see you walking. Left you hopeless. I feel dry.
Yeah. I moved on
because I thought that I was strong. I was thinking about myself. Don't have too much to say, but the Lord has made me pray. to someone new.
The band that changed my life, it's always an interesting conversation to have people who like music, like the band that made you like music. For me, it was definitely At The Drive-In in seventh grade. I was given a CD by one of my friends. I went to this new school and I started hanging out with this one kid who was like a total weirdo, and he's like gave me this relationship of command, and that was like kind of what made me like give up all the Eminem and stuff. And I don't know, I still like Eminem a little bit. What about you?
See, I don't know. That's such a hard question.
Yeah,
I
her
talk
parents
about...
were like punk rock and stuff, so she had cool music like from
no,
the
No, but
day
I also,
she was born.
When I was little, like loved Spice Girls and stuff like
yeah,
that.
Well,
but
that's
my
inevitable.
The first record that I actually bought was The Clash, I think.
It's always music first, like, you know, we don't sit around like composing lyrics in, on the regular. I feel like that's a really weird thing to do. But we just, you know, it's always like sometimes, it usually starts with music, and the music will get to a point, and then there's like some kind of like conference between Madeline and I where we'll be like, okay, well, what's this song gonna be about? Like, what's this song, you know, like, what's the setting, what kind of characters, like, where's it all gonna go? And that'll like inform the music at the same time as it informs the lyrics. So I'll be finishing up the music and Madeline will be writing like melodies and lyrics at the same time. Because, you know, I have a little desk in our apartment where I have like a laptop, two speakers, and like a keyboard, and then that's kind of where everything happens, you know? But yeah, so it's just, I don't know, it's really natural. If the song like clicks and the idea is good, we can do a song in an hour, you know? But that's the hard
Not
part.
Not finish a song in an hour, but
you could.
Come up with the blueprint.
Yeah. But it's the, you know, the hard part is when is finding the songs that click like that. Like the songs that, like, you know, you understand together what it's gonna be and you can make it like that. It's like, you know, people say like, draw a picture of a dog, and like 9 times out of 10, you're like, it's just not gonna work out. That's an ongoing idea that we're working on. We have one song that we're working on with Freddie Gibbs right now that should be coming out pretty soon. But I've learned that this is a much harder thing to organize than I hoped it would be. So the song that's almost done is gonna be awesome. So that'll be out in like the next couple months. It was you know, an idea that Isaiah had, Isaiah Surrett, the director, like, you know, we were really self-conscious about making a video for that song because, I don't know, it's like a really personal song for us on the one end, and on the other end, it's really kind of obtuse lyrically, you know what I mean? Like, it's kind of, it's so, like, you know, in your face or whatever. You don't want to make, like, something that's directly correlated because it'd just be, you know, annoying. But, and then so we found this idea, and like everybody was saying it was impossible. Like there was no way that the you know the archive was gonna sign off on the footage. There was no way that people were gonna be able to accept it. And we were like, we gotta try. So then we called all the people, and like everybody was really excited about it, about like bringing back like you know the history and the idea of the event to like a new generation through like a video. So when we tried to make the video, we tried to just like tell the story of that whole thing, because this a lot of the song is about like control. It's about like people that try to like you know take your life and turn it into something else because they're you know mean or lazy, or they try to get in your way and make you feel like you can't be creative or do what you want to do. And then in the end, you know, like it's about this in the song and in the video, it's about like you know walking away from that and going to do your own thing. So it felt like a really strong parallel. Like we felt really you know close to that whole story. And then everybody, you know, has the response has been awesome.
The reaction's been amazing. So many people have sent emails like, I didn't even know that Jim Jones existed. I didn't know anything about Jonestown, and I just spent 3 hours online researching Jim Jones. And like, it's, I don't know, it's amazing.
He did a really good job of like compressing the whole tale into like 3 minute, half minute pop song. So yeah, we're really stoked on it too.